Trials of a Royal Guard by Ansel. Chapter 48. Time to rest. Standing on the balcony above the main hall brought back wonderful memories of Princess Luna, Iridescence, and I playing board games during the Grand Galloping Gala. The princess hadn't wanted to attend, so we had kept her company while on duty. It had been an informal affair, too. I'd been very uncomfortable with the idea of doing anything but standing guard, but the mayors had forced the issue and I complied. We watched from the very spot I was standing on. That was a gala to remember, since everything fell apart, literally. Lieutenant Gloam, I want you to put your two best archers up here. Inconspicuously, of course, I ordered. Yes, Major, he replied. We're set, then. I need to get downstairs and greet my wife. See to your duty. Yes, sir. I left him there and made my way downstairs and into the main hall. It was packed full of beautifully appointed tables and the ponies that would fill them were already starting to wander in. Each seat had a place setting and a nameplate. I'd helped plan them all as tactically as I could, which is to say, I guessed. Willowy Tempest and Raven had done an amazing job with the decorations. The hall was full of brightly colored unicorn lamps, equestrian heraldry, and the unit standard from every single brigade that served in the war. They'd even cheated a bit and hung the Dragoon's banner even though we had only been a company. In truth, I think it was Willowy's way of apologizing to me. We'd left on rough terms, and Crystal had mentioned that Willowy had always felt guilty about it. It was a nice gesture. I still didn't really like her. She was pushy and controlling. That was a very small concern, though, and wasn't important enough to dwell on. Making my way through the tables was turning out to be far more difficult than I'd anticipated. Many of the soldiers and officers I passed wanted to shake my hoof and speak to me a moment. Some of them I knew decently well. Others were just faces I remembered. Even more still were ponies that I didn't know but knew me for my deeds. My company had saved a lot of lives and so many of these ponies had stories of the Dragoons coming to their rescue. In some cases, it was me personally. Eventually, I was able to make enough polite excuses to get to table 9 where I found an elegant mare sitting in a beautiful pink ball gown. Well, hello, miss. I can't believe you're alone. The unicorn mare tossed her blonde and pink mane. It's Mrs., and my husband is a Royal Guard officer, so you should be careful, she replied. I took her hoof in mine and kissed it softly. So am I. In fact, I bet I could take him in a fight. Crystal giggled and waved her free hoof. I doubt that very much, he's quite as would you two quit being so romantic? You're going to make me sick. When did you get so sappy, silent? Winterspear groaned from the seat beside my wife. I glared at her. Don't be jealous that all of the magic is gone from your relationship. I'm dating a romance writer, so I have to keep up my A-game. Winterspear's eyes narrowed. You and I are going to wrestle about this later. Crystal shook her head, grinning. She kissed me softly. You look so handsome. And you look as beautiful as the day I married you. I'm very sorry that I can't dine with you tonight. I've been invited to sit with the princesses, minister, and general. Winterspear snorted. Yeah, go figure. Silent Night is some stallions plus one. And I'm the filly fooler. I looked at Crystal curiously and whispered, she's awfully surly tonight. Crystal patted me on the shoulder. She's upset that Iridescence has to work the event and that she wasn't invited to the main hall. She was at a foyer table, but I asked her to be my plus one. Ah, that made sense. Winterspear wasn't a veteran exactly. She also wasn't a high-ranking officer or official. She did amazing work, but her support role wouldn't rate for the main hall. I could see her feeling left out. I kissed Crystal once more and moved past her to my sister. I looped my four hooves around her from behind and set my chin on her head. I'm sorry you feel left out. What you do is extremely important. The rule was just to get as many combat veterans as far up the list as possible. Winterspear set her hooves over mine and grumbled, I know. It doesn't make you less important. I know, okay, I whispered before kissing between her ears. You ladies have fun. I need to do one more check and then head up front. See you later. Before I pulled away, I tweaked Winterspear's rank pin, turning it sideways. Okay, Winterspear replied, sounding a bit more chipper as she fumbled with the pin. Crystal tossed her mane. Yes, run along, little soldier stallion. Just remember whose bed you're supposed to come home to later. I could never forget that. I chuckled before leaving them for the grand entry that dominated the west side of the room. It was the one being protected by Princess Luna's house guard. Iridescence was standing just inside it holding a clipboard. When I trotted up, she and all but one of the other house guards stood at attention. I waved a hoof. At ease. Are you going to explain this? Miley and the lieutenant won't explain this, Iridescence said before I could get another word in. Her hoof was pointing at Exemplar Feral. Or that. Her hoof went the other way, gesturing at Tranquil Dusk. The Exemplar and Dusk had been playing the role of PLHG for over a week and were now standing guard. In Feral's case, her armor wasn't fit exactly right and, for some reason, it stood out as odd on her. I nodded. I'll explain it. Good. Some pony needs to. You can't just put a temple guard and a civilian in our armor and tell us they're new. I know who they are. I was there in Nordenver and I was there when you got back from Haven. SHH, I hissed before leaning in close to Iridescence. Feral is giving us a hoof with her future sight. We wanted her to blend in, and Tranquil Dusk keeps an eye on her, so the same thing goes. I knew you'd go along with it even if it upset you. Iridescence grumbled, oh, I'm upset. Upset that no pony, especially you, came to tell me when it happened. Come on, Silent, you owe me more than that. I sat a hoof on hers. I do, I'm sorry. There was a lot going on and I knew I could trust you. It won't happen again, I promise. Well, all right, then. After tonight, we stop pretending that Guard First Class Feral isn't a centuries-old Unicorn Temple Exemplar. Yes, probably. I think yes. I'll let you know. Iridescence groaned and rolled her eyes. Fine, but you owe me. I chuckled and nodded. Agreed. Crystal and I will take Dot off your hooves for an entire weekend. Colts and all. The mare didn't hesitate for half a second before she replied, all is forgiven. Now, move along. Do you see the line of ponies out this door? We have to check them all in. Yes, ma'am, I replied before moving over to where Exemplar Feral was pretending to stand guard. Good evening, Silent Knight, she said softly. Good evening. Guard First Class. Is there anything I need to look out for? Any visions of doom or vague warnings? Poor feelings in the belly. Exemplar Feral shook her head. No, though this may distress you equally. I have not had a vision for 5 days. In the ages I have lived since receiving my cutie mark, I have never gone such a long time without some views of the future. No visions? No subtle and convoluted warnings? No prophecies? That was disturbing. Why do you think that is? I asked. She shook her head. I cannot say. They have simply stopped and I am able to remain in the here and now like a normal pony. It is liberating. Liberating was great. At least for her. I had an operation to run and assassins potentially within striking distance. I realized my jaw was clenching, so I relaxed it. Can we try to restore them? It is a huge advantage. Maybe if you held my hoof that would trigger one. I asked, offering it to her. The unicorn reached out reluctantly. She did not take my hoof immediately and, instead, seemed to think that over. What if I do not wish to have visions any longer, despite the danger? Living in constant visions was likely not much of a life. It was a concept I struggled with understanding, but I'd seen the results in her actions. The ability to see and remember potential futures was a huge gift but also a curse since she had no control over it. Danger or not, was it right to try to force it? Like the war was forced on me? No. Perhaps at one time I'd have said yes. That everything had to be done to advance our duty. To protect our princesses. There were limits, though. That was what Stratus Knight never taught. Unbalanced ponies who couldn't learn those limits were actually worse soldiers. I smiled and shook my head. Then don't take my hoof. You've earned some rest and we should not rely solely on your visions. My hoof slowly lowered. Exemplar Feral blinked at that. Then she smiled. It was a big, beautiful smile that caused her crystal blue eyes to close ever so slightly. A smile I'd never seen from her. It is my choice. All mine, she whispered before reaching out and grabbing my hoof. I held onto it while she stared off into space. Only instead of the normal vacant look, her eyes kept flicking between me and across the room. Feral. Nothing is happening, nothing. She shook her head and let my hoof go. Nothing. I saw nothing. She then pressed her hoof against my face. Nothing. It is gone. The hairs of my mane stood up a bit. Does that mean you don't have the ability anymore, or there is nothing in the future? I do not know, she admitted. But I choose to believe the former. Be not distressed. Perhaps this is for the best. I can help more in the here and now. My magic is powerful and I am a fit warrior. Yes. Okay, I'm going to try not to be distressed. We'll just march forwards. Now, I need to get to my spot. Keep an eye out, all right. The mare nodded with resolve. As you wish. We parted ways then, nerves wiggling into my stomach. I'd always begrudged her visions. Now that they were gone, I felt left out in the dark. We can't have it both ways, can we, Silent? Why not? Hush. On my way over to the head tables, I stopped by where Tranquil Dusk stood in a set of armor. She was similarly disguised in the same way that Exemplar Feral was. Our eyes met, I nodded, and she returned it without a grimace. That was probably progress for us. If I'd had more time, I'd have stopped. I approached the head table and Minister Sombra waved me over to the seat next to him. There he is, he said with a pleased smile. It never fails that Major Knight is going to check on everything before relaxing. General Ironhoof was on the other side of him, and both princesses were opposite the two of them. A few brigadiers and government officials were also at the round table, but most of them were just names on a plate for me. I bowed. My apologies, every pony. It is as the minister said. I needed to check on my wife and then on my former subordinates. Old habits die hard. Princess Luna softly smiled. I imagine that you'd rather be on guard duty, even despite our company. As I settled into my chair, I nodded. As I said, old habits, and I've always enjoyed your company, even when on duty. Princess Celestia shook her head. I should have snatched you up the day Shining Armor brought you in. You're so level-headed and work-focused. Look at Sunny over there. She's pouting because she has to work. We all turned our heads to where Sunny was standing at the entry opposite the one I'd checked. When she saw us, her eyes narrowed and she stuck her tongue out at Princess Celestia before pointing a hoof at her eyes and then at me. Princess Luna laughed and shook her head. Too bad. You gave him to me, and now he's mine. Minister Sombra cleared his throat. Ideally, he'll remain in my service. Though I wouldn't dare to try to pull him away from you, if that is the choice he makes. He was an excellent member of my command staff, Ironhoof put in. Although you don't have to worry about me trying to take him. Once every pony is settled, I've decided to retire. I made eye contact with him and nodded. He nodded back. He was rescuing me from the awkward conversation. Regrettable to lose such a seasoned leader, but well deserved, I'd say, the minister replied, accepting the change of subjects. Without question, Princess Luna put in. Yes, we've called upon you a few too many times, Iron Hoof, Princess Celestia said. This last time far more than the sum of the others put together. You are, without a doubt, one of our greatest warriors. There was light tapping of hooves on the table in absolute agreement. General Ironhoof was probably the greatest military mind of our generation. Especially now. We'd been behind on tactics at the start of the war, but he had quickly come up to speed and surpassed our more warlike enemies. Serving ponies had started to arrive with water, wine, and hors d'oeuvres. Many of the tables were now starting to fill up and the banquet was officially beginning, even if it had been designed as an informal event from a speaking perspective. General Ironhoof waved his hoof. It was my duty, honor, and privilege to serve this kingdom when it needed me most. Some ponies have to be ready for the horrible nature of the world outside our borders. My only regret is that so many saw it this time around. Mine, too, I chimed in before quickly adding, my apologies. I spoke out of turn. Minister Sombra shook his head. Hardly. You're a guest at this table like any pony else, silent. You saw more combat in one war than most ponies ever will in an entire career. I nodded. Thank you. What was so awful about this war is that it got out of hoof and we had to extend beyond the army. We sent ponies that weren't prepared to see what we saw. I'm not even sure I really was. We're looking at years of work to calm the nerves of those ponies. Princess Luna put in quickly, and we will. We will be there with them for as long as it takes. The table went silent then. It was one of those long, awkward silences where every pony understood the gravity of the topic but wanted to avoid it. In time, Princess Celestia set her hooves on the table and chimed in, I'm doing something special for Sunny's birthday. Can you all keep a secret? There was general agreement around the table that we could, as well as a great sense of relief. A birthday was far more suitable topic for a joyful occasion. Princess Celestia smiled. Wonderful. I am sending her on an assignment to Tall Tale. I'm going to pretend that I have forgotten her birthday altogether and callously force her to work on it. She'll believe it is just an assignment and be furious with me. When she arrives, she'll just be so angry. The princess's smile turned mischievous. Of course, what she'll discover is that her mother and sister will be waiting for her at the train station with Azurite and Soren. It's 2 weeks of vacation with every pony she loves. Sending Sunny away even in the face of a hidden enemy? Perhaps the princess was not as concerned as I was. Princess Luna grinned. Every pony but you. Princess Celestia snorted. You know what I mean. I can't go jaunting off to Tall Tale on a moment's notice. The ponies around the table chuckled, giggled, and tapped their hooves. They loved the idea of tricking Sunny. I honestly did, too, if I didn't need Captain Day so much. She was a valuable asset. Minister Sombra cleared his throat. On that topic, Silent Knight has informed me that he too is planning to take some leave shortly. It seems we've worn him out. General Ironhoof leaned forwards to look past the minister at me. Oh? And where are you planning to go? I cleared my throat. On the spot again in front of all of these important ponies. To be perfectly honest, we're going to be visiting Glimmer World. I realize it may be geared more for older fillies and colts, but we just loved it there. After that, we'll escape to a small island for some time away from the wild crowds and tourists. It is another one of the special places we share. Princess Luna softly smirked behind a hoof, giggling. The minister's ear flicked. Am I missing something? Oh, my sister seems to think that Silent Night and Crystal Wishes are finally going to begin, nesting, Princess Celestia explained. Especially on this trip since I suspect that the island Silent Night has mentioned is where they went on their honeymoon. My face felt flush. How had this gotten so out of hoof? Meddling mares. The princess is relentless in her pursuit for what she'll view as her grand foals. General Ironhoof laughed heartily and leaned back in his chair. Then you'd best get to work, Major. Alicorns, despite being ageless, are not known for their endless patience. Princess Celestia's ears stood up. Is that so, General? Without a moment's hesitation, the General replied, In my experience, yes, ma'am. When it comes to foals, fun, and cake, alicorns seem to be most impatient. At least, that is to say, the only alicorn I've had the esteemed pleasure of knowing well is that way. Princess Luna gently prodded her sister with a hoof. I believe the General's assessment to be baseless, when it comes to me. For you, he is as astute as always. And so he is, Princess Celestia replied before pushing back at the hoof. Raven trotted over. Princesses, apologies for the interruption, but most every pony has arrived. The entry lines have reduced to a trickle. You may make your toasts at your leisure. Princess Celestia replied, Thank you, Raven. Well, ponies, duty calls. She then stood and levitated her crystal goblet and a spoon. Gently, she tapped the pair together, filling the room with a soft tinking. Ponies, ponies, if I may have your attention, please. The room fell quiet and all eyes turned towards the radiant alicorn. Today is a special day. It is the first time in a long time that we've all been together. That may not seem like much to many, but to me, it is a miracle. I have promised myself that I would not cry, nor would I make this toast long. It is important that you know, however, that you are all my little ponies, and your absence has been felt deeply. Each day you were missed not just by your family but by your kingdom and your princesses. Thank you for coming home. Please, lift a glass as we toast your safe return. Every pony in the room did so and we all repeated, to safe returns. The room then erupted into eager cheers and thumping of hooves on the tables. It was a brilliant toast. Short, sweet, and meaningful. Princess Luna then stood and nodded at her sister. In a similar fashion, she brought her spoon to her goblet and clinked them together. It is also my pleasure to address you, Todd Silent. To arms. Sunny Day shouted, cutting off the princess. The room went silent and every pony turned to look at the golden mare. She was in her battle stance, her horn lit. I quickly scanned the room and couldn't see any threats. Just confusion sweeping the crowd. This was not the kind of prank Sunny would pull, but there was nothing. Nothing was wrong. Nothing, Silent? Look closer. A chill ran over me, setting the hairs of my coat on end. In unison, 20 ponies around the room stood up. Their eyes went vacant and began to glow purple. My heart started to race and time seemed to slow. This was it. There wasn't a single assassin. They'd gotten too many. Tick. Lieutenant Gloam, subdue them. I ordered loudly as I leaped onto the table and moved towards the princesses. Goblets, plates, and flatware went flying as I hurried across. Talk. The house and royal guards were already moving towards the ponies even before I'd issued the call to do so. I'd ordered subdue because I doubted these poor veterans had any control over themselves. Cries of confusion and warning rang out from both sides of the room. Tick. More soldiers with glowing eyes were trying to force their way in from the outside, effectively blocking both entries. The house guards were dealing with them, but the chaos was building. I looked around, assessing the situation as fast as I could. They'd trapped us. Was the plan to simply overwhelm us? The enemy hoped we wouldn't kill our own? It was a good hope. The thought turned my stomach. I caught sight of the balcony. We could fly up there. Princesses talk. Princess Celestia stood to her full height, her horn bursting with golden light. Enough. She stomped a hoof and a glimmering wave exploded from where it contacted with the stone floor and crashed across the room. All of the soldiers with purple eyes stopped moving, the glow flickering out. Their eyes returned to normal and they stood idly about, looking confused and concerned. Many didn't understand why they were grappling with palace guards. She'd done it. Whatever hold the nightmares had on the ponies wasn't enough to stop an alicorn. I breathed a sigh of relief, until I heard the cackling in my mind. Tick. Not enough. Your will is not strong enough, little student. I will have the usurper whether you like it or not. The voice rattled within my skull, infecting my thoughts. Come along, little stallion. You belong to me, too. My vision stared to blur. No, fight this, silent. I reached out and set a hoof on Princess Luna's shoulder. She was warm and soft. Attack. No. I yanked my hoof away and shook my head. My vision cleared. Purple and black energy had once again erupted from the eyes of the soldiers, sending them back into their controlled state. They started to fight harder against the royal guards, surging towards us. Princess Luna's horn lit repeatedly, firing off low-powered beams to knock them down. There was a battle playing out across the room. The guards and unaffected soldiers were doing their best to stop their comrades without killing them. Talk. The air changed as energy crackled through it. I spotted the source quickly. Brigadier Hammer's horn was glowing as he charged an attack. I'd seen him do it in battle numerous times. That much energy would not subdue. It would kill. He turned towards us and away from all of the commotion. There was a clear line of sight between him and the princesses. No, Tick. I tried to cry out a warning, but there wasn't time as the blasts of lightning burst from the unicorn's horn. They were tinged with black as they surged towards Princess Luna. I did the only thing I knew how to do. I jumped in the way. When they slammed into my unarmored form, some pony screamed in the distance. Talk. The hair of my coat burned away, as did my wing feathers. It felt like I was on fire as I crumbled to the floor. My forehoof came up to point at the balcony, but it barely moved. In the haze of pain, I could see it was blackened. Soft hooves looped around me. The touch was excruciating. It was Princess Luna. She was cradling me. This is it, silent. No. Yes, this is it. You did your duty. Not done. We're done. Tick. Silent, Princess Luna whispered as her tears fell onto my face. My mouth didn't work right, but as best could, I whispered, tell. Crystal, sorry. And that is how I died. Talk. Author's note. Hello, lovely readers. Please be mindful of the critical nature of this chapter and use the spoiler feature to protect your peers. They'll appreciate it in the future. Temporary note, February 6, 2017. As a reminder to everyone, TOA.rg will be on a short hiatus as I work on writing the next part as a complete story instead of a week-to-week serial. I also have a Hearts and Hooves Day story to put out for you to enjoy and laugh at. If you are enjoying this story, please consider taking a look at Crystal and Maya's website quillandblade.com for extra content such as mini stories, an Ask Us form to submit questions, responses to said questions, and special rewards for the awesome folks who support our Patreon. End author's note.